Hey, what's up guys? Jeremy here from RoboDK. Welcome to another tutorial series covering, this time, the main components of RoboDK. My goal here is to give you enough knowledge so that, by yourself, you can use the full potential of RoboDK. For example, we will talk about the usage of reference frame, the settings surrounding the objects, and the robot configurations. Essentially, we will see the details of some of the things I quickly showed you in my previous series. You should clearly start by watching the basic guide series. It will give you all the tools needed to follow this tutorial. We will start this series by the most important topic of all, the robot. You will use one every time you use RoboDK, so you'd better understand it well. Robots are the heart of any RoboDK project. It's so important to understand it well that I decided to create two videos on the subject. Let's get started with part one. In the basic guide series, I showed you how to import a robot. You open your online library, you select the robot you want, and you download it. Pretty straightforward. So the model of the robot is right here in your station, and you can see its name here in the station tree. This time I imported an ABB IRB120. For ABB, the other numbers means the payload, so 3 kg, and the reach, 0.6 meter. I believe that this number is a rounding of the reach. If I remember well, the actual reach is a little less than that. We can easily verify this information by going back to the library. Just below the 3D model of the robot we selected, you can find common information about it. Here we can see that the reach is in fact 580 millimeters, so I was right. I was also correct for the payload, 3 kg, and the repeatability of this robot is pretty good at 0.01 millimeters, or 10 microns. While we are in the online library, let's look at the available robots. In terms of brand, we obviously have the big names, ABB, Fanuc, KUKA, Motoman, UR, but we also have a lot of smaller brands, including newer players like Mechademic. In terms of robot type, we have some 5 degrees of freedom, a large number of standard 6 degrees of freedom, and the most common 7 degrees of freedom. You can also find Delta robots. Most of them have 3 or 5 degrees of freedom depending. Those are very fast robots. The motors are all fixed to the base instead of being fixed along the arms. By doing so, you reduce the weight of the moving parts. And by reducing the weight, you also reduce the inertia, and you obtain better acceleration and deceleration. They are mostly used in the packaging and food industry, I would say. Okay, we also have the palletizing robot. Those robots usually look like standard robot arms, but they only have 4 degrees of freedom. Movement in X, Y, and Z, and rotation around Z. For palletizing tasks, the other two rotations are not necessary. Removing them simplified the robot mechanism and focused the design on reach and payload. Very useful for their purposes. We also have some SCARA robot, another really quick type of robot mostly used to handle small parts. Even if those are not really robots, we can quickly take a look at the external axis. We have turntables, some with two external axes, we have linear tracks, we even have some gantries. This will also be a nice subject for a future video. Okay, if you ever need a robot and can't find it in the online library, don't panic. You simply need to find the 3D model of the robot with its datasheet. Once you have that in hand, there are two solutions. If you own a professional license and you are willing to wait a few business days, you can send us an email and we will help you. If you don't own a professional license, or if you are in a very time-sensitive situation, you can open the Model, Mechanism, and Robot tool and create yourself a 6-axis robot. You can find a diagram pretty much like this one in your robot datasheet. Those are the informations you need, plus the 3D model, to create a robot and add it to your personal library. Once your robot is added to your personal library, you can access it directly through this icon. I will create a video in the future explaining in details how you can create mechanisms and robots using this tool. Okay, for the next section of the tutorial, I will close this station. I will go to the local library and open the example basic cell project. It's a pretty simple cell. It uses an IRB 120, same as the one we had before, and some kind of pen tool. It's also composed of a reference frame called reference frame and a target called target 1. First, double click the robot, either its name in the station tree or the 3D model itself, to open the robot panel. Here comes the robot panel on the right of your screen, so let's look at the details. On top we have, obviously, the name of the robot, and on the right, some parameters. Let's open that new window. Here, we have the name of the robot again, and just below, the speed parameters for the robot. So, linear speed and acceleration, and joint speed and joint acceleration. Most of the time, you don't have to change these values. They are provided in the documentation of your robot. Just underneath that, you can select the default post-processor for the robot. Now I'm using the ABB IRC5, but I could decide to switch to the ABB S4, for example. The worst part here is that I don't even know if an ABB 120 could be supported by an S4 controller. I really have my doubts about that, so let's switch back to the IRC5 post-processor. Okay, we won't talk about the rest of the page here because everything is pretty much linked to the robot calibration. Accuracy is such an important topic of robotics that I prefer creating a video especially for it. At the moment, you just need to know that RoboDK can help you improve the precision of your robot by up to 10 folds. If you have questions concerning high precision robotics, you can contact us on our forum or through our website contact form. Before going back to the robot panel, note that we have the Set Home Position button here. I will talk about it in the part 2 of this video. Okay, close that. I already talked about some of the next sections in my robot movement tutorial, which is part of the basic guide series. Let's cover it anyway. The first section is the Cartesian Jog section. With this section, you will be able to do two things. Move the robot in the XYZ environment, or retrieve the position of the robot in the XYZ environment. Let's say that this section is separated in three blocks. The first one concerns the tool. On the first line, you can see which tool is currently activated. If I add another tool, let's add just a TCP without 3D model. So if I add another tool, I can change the activated tool with that drop-down menu. You can see the green dot switching from one tool to the other. Okay, let's go back to the pen tool and delete the new tool I just created. Below that, you can also see the distance between the coordinate system of the robot flange and the TCP or tool center point. The drop-down menu here lets you choose how to display the coordinate system values. The default settings give you the X, Y, and Z values, followed by the rotation around Z, Y prime, and X prime prime. These are the standard Euler angles used by ABB. So if you are familiar with ABB, you can stick to this one, but you can also change the method to use something more familiar or maybe less confusing. Maybe we could use the Fenwick/Modaman 1. This one is the most straightforward, I believe. So X, Y, and Z translation, and X, Y, and Z rotation. By the way, Euler angles is not a simple subject to learn. If you are fairly new to robotics, I highly recommend you to get informed on the subject. And I would even say, get informed on the general subject of robot mathematics. Don't forget that a robot is just a pile of metal controlled by a mathematical model. It's not a requirement to program robots. You can go pretty far without knowing it, but knowing part of the maths behind robots can be a real asset in some tricky situation. That being said, let's go back to the default settings. On the side, you have three buttons. The first one lets you copy the pose, so let's do that. Now I copied the values of all those text boxes. and now I can change one or many values, just like that. Note that my TCP is not at the right place anymore. Considering that I copied the previous pose of the TCP onto my clickboard, I can use the second button, which is paste. By doing so, I pasted the old values in those text boxes, and the TCP went back to its original spot. The last button gives you access to the rest of the options. You can copy the values instead of the pose, you can paste the values, you can invert your pose mathematical model, or you can reset the values back to zero, just like that. I still have the TCP pose on my clickboard, so I can press paste again to retrieve the TCP position. The second block is the reference frame. At first, you can see which reference frame is activated at the moment. Then, in a similar way as for the TCP, if I had more than one reference frame, I could select the one I want to activate. And I can see the position of that reference frame with respect, instead of the flange, to the robot base. By the way, the third topic of this series will exclusively talk about reference frame. I will explain you in detail why you should use them. I will also tell you what I mean by a position with respect to. You simply have to subscribe to our YouTube channel, hit the bell button, and you will receive a notification as soon as we release it. Okay, the last block gives you the value of the TCP pose with respect to the activated reference frame. Here, it means the distance between this reference frame origin and the TCP here. We covered very well the next section in the robot movements video. In a few words, it gives you a way to manually jog the robot as you would do using your teach pendant. You can move with respect to the tool frame, the activated reference frame, or the robot base. You can either do translation along X, Y, and Z, and rotation around X, Y, and Z. Let's do a few tests. So this is a rotation around the X of the tool, and this is a rotation around the Z of the tool. Now that the TCP is at an angle, it will be easier to see the difference between the tool and reference frame translation. Let's move along the x-axis of the tool. And now let's compare with the translation along the x-axis of the reference frame. As you can see, the first move follows that x-axis, and the second move follows that x-axis. So the first move follows the tool x-axis, like that. And the second one, the reference frame x-axis, just like this. Okay, perfect. Okay, that's pretty much everything for today's video. If you think those videos are helpful, please hit the thumbs up button. Also, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. That way you can come back and look at the newest tutorial. The second part of the robot tutorial is coming very soon. Have a good day, guys.